As a video control engineer, tell us what your responsibilities were.
Well, the basically the adjustment of the camera electrically. And at that time, it was really by the seat of your pants. It was none. It was not instrument flying. And your personality could enter into the result that you got. And it's because you had control of this terrible camera, and you could make it look good or bad. And you could also improve it slightly. And in many cases, you can improve it greatly. And that's really, as I mentioned before, started the interest in lighting, because I realized that there was a much, much greater effect from the effect of lighting than the electronic effect. And the camera was difficult to use, and it was, again, all new to us. And so as a result, the operations, it was a much more interesting job then, because it was so difficult because of the shortcomings of the system. Today, this is going to offend my video friends, but the camera can work equally as well in the automatic condition as it does when being manually adjusted.
There was one technician, though, who controlled what the picture looked like as it went out in the air.
And that was the video man. That was your job.
Yeah.
That was your job.
But in the booth, didn't somebody adjust the technical director?
No, the technical director was basically performed the switching function and was the supervisor of the crew. NBC was unique in that, in their operations. The technical director had much more control than being just performing the switching function from camera to camera, and actually would have a great deal to add to the production in the choice of cameras and a dialogue with the director that's very similar to the dialogue that a director of photography today would have with a director. That particular function has decreased rather quickly. There was a time, for example, at NBC that the director was not allowed to talk to the cameraman. Now that's an interesting concept. So that the technical director had a great deal more authority. He was actually also in charge of the administration of the crew, the time in times, who was assigned to what, all of this kind of business, and he was always on site. And the hours, of course, that everybody talks about during those periods, for a lighting person, were extensive.
Tell us who else was in the control room on a live show in those days.
A live show, you had, of course, the director, and then the technical director, the director's assistant, who was the associate director, who for the live show, of course, had a tremendous responsibility because there was the timing of the show, because these things had to end exactly on time, begin and end. And of course, very important. Then there was the audio engineer who was responsible for the audio of the show, and perhaps he had an assistant to play the turntable or something. Remember, this is all pre-tape. And that was about it. And the video man. There was no production assistant. There was no Chiron operator. There was no a cueing device was not in there. There was no tape playback for the audio. So it was a rather intimate group. And so that when NBC changed the radio studios into television studios, they just kind of moved, put in another room, left the audio console, because there was this limited number of people that had to be in there. So there were very, very small, tight control rooms. Nothing like you see today, where you have perhaps, I saw some new ones, for example, at Fox, that had five rows of desks. Well, that's a lot of people. But it was very, very intimate.